Here comes the boss. Must be time to start work.
Yeah, will you listen to that noise? Sounds like a Tappet. Wouldn't you think he'd fix it?
Morning, boys. I know, sounds like a Tappet noise, doesn't it? Just started this morning. Thought it'd go away by the time I got here, but it hasn't. Want to help me fix it?
Sure, Sid. What do you suppose is causing it?
Hey, that's not a question you can answer on the spur of the moment. If the noise lasts more than a few minutes after the engine started, you'll have to check and find the cause.
How about giving us the story on hydraulic Tappets sometime, Sid?
We'll do it right now, John. Let me shut the engine off here. I'll get some Tappets and explain how they work. There they are. Suppose I start out by explaining...
Hey, wait for me. You wouldn't talk about hydraulic Tappets without having old Tech on hand, would you?
Sure wouldn't, Tech. I'll need you to help me explain the different types of hydraulic Tappets used in our V8 engines. This one, for instance, is used in the Chrysler firepower engines. A similar type is used in the DeSoto fire dome engines. This is known as the replaceable unit type Tappet. The plunger and cylinder with a check ball, which make up the hydraulic unit, can be replaced as an assembly in the Tappet body.
That's right. The plunger and cylinder are selectively fitted to each other, but not to the Tappet body. So you can replace those two parts as an assembly without having to replace the body.
Isn't there another design of the ball check type of Tappet used too, Sid?
Yes, there is. Here's one of them. This is known as an integral type Tappet, because it's replaceable only as a complete unit.
Show them what's inside of it, Sid.
Inside the Tappet body, we find a plunger spring, a check ball and retainer, a plunger and cap. A spring clip snaps into a groove in the upper end of the Tappet body to hold the assembly together. You can identify this type of Tappet by the two wide oil feed grooves around the body and the fact that it's shorter than the other.
And this type of Tappet is used in Dodge Red Ram engines.
Now let's take a look at this other type of Tappet. It's also an integral type assembly, but it's known as the flat valve design.
You'll notice that there's only one oil feed groove around the Tappet body of the flat valve type.
Right, Tech. Inside the Tappet body, we find a plunger spring, valve retainer, valve spring, check valve, and a plunger and cap. These parts are also held in the Tappet body by a spring clip.
Remember, these integral type Tappets are serviced as complete assemblies only. You can't get the inside part separately.
That's right, Tech.
Just how do these hydraulic Tappets operate, Sid?
Let me tell him, Sid. You and Tech can check me if I get off the beam.
Sure, Fred. Go ahead.
Well, to begin with, they have to have oil inside, because oil is what keeps the valve train clearances closed up.
Now, that's a bright remark. Hydraulic Tappets have oil in them. I wonder if he figured that out all by himself.
Give him a chance, Tech. Let's see how he gets along.
When the engine is started, the pump forces oil through the main oil galleries and through drilled passages from the galleries to the Tappet guides. When the oil feed groove in the Tappet body lines up with a hole in the Tappet guide, oil is forced into the Tappet. Of course, the Tappet is moving all the time, so it may have to make several cycles before it gets filled with oil. And you must remember that it takes some Tappets longer than others to fill up.
Yeah? How come?
Elementary, my dear Watson. When the engine stops, some of the valves are going to be open. This means the valve springs of those valves will be applying a steady pressure on the Tappets, while the springs of the closed valves apply no pressure.
So the Tappets that get the steady pressure will bleed down more than the others.
This boy Fred is mighty sharp.
That I'll admit. Because some Tappets bleed down, it's normal to expect some of the Tappets to be noisy when the engine is started.
Right. Sometimes it takes a few minutes for the noise to go away.
Yeah? But what about Sid's car? He's been on the road more than a few minutes, and he's still got a noisy Tappet.
But we're not sure it is a Tappet, John. We're going to find out, though.
Well, let's suppose it is. What would make it noisy after the engine was warmed up?
You better take over, Sid. I'm not sure I can answer that.
Well, if the noise doesn't go away when the job's warmed up, it's either caused by air in the Tappet, dirt carried in by the oil, or could be a faulty Tappet.
Of course, it could be a combination of any of those.
That's right. Suppose we talk first about air in the Tappet. That's the most common cause of noise.
I suppose air could get in when the engine started running if the tappet had bled down quite a bit while the engine was shut off.
But I should think that air would work out during the first few minutes of running.
It will, too. But air can get in while the engine's running. But tell them how, Sid.
If the oil level in the crankcase is low, or if the floating oil strainer happens to get stuck in the raised position, the pump will suck in air. And if there's too much oil in the crankcase, it may get churned up by the crankshaft. That'll make the oil foamy, and the pump will send air bubbles through the oil galleries and into the tappets.
That's right. I never thought of that.
Now don't kid yourself about that oil level. It's important. The time to check the level is a couple of minutes after you shut the engine off, after it has been running at least 5 minutes.
Well, what difference does it make when you check it? You only got so much oil in there.
Are we going to have trouble with you now? You better wise him up, Sid.
Some oil will drain back from the oil galleries, John. And if the car has the engine-fed torque converter, some oil may drain back from the converter. You see, that drain tube can set up a siphoning action on the oil in the converter and cause some of it to drain into the crankcase.
Isn't there some way to stop that, Sid?
Yes, there is. You can vent that drain pipe by drilling a 3/32 hole in it close to the edge of the block. That'll break up the siphoning action.
Be sure to drill that hole on the side of the pipe away from the crankshaft, so the oil from that hole will strike the side of the oil pan. It'll create bubbles if it splashes off the crankshaft.
How about the drain back from the oil galleries? Can you stop that too?
You won't be bothered with drain back from the oil galleries on those jobs equipped with a full-flow oil filter, because there's a check valve in the filter. But engines equipped with a shunt-type oil filter may have a little drain back that'll have a tendency to raise the oil level. So the tappets will be noisy for a minute or so until the oil galleries fill up and oil reaches the tappets. There's a new check valve available for engines equipped with the shunt-type filter to stop the oil from draining out of the oil galleries. Just remove the rear main bearing cap and install the check valve in the oil delivery passage flush with the block. The O-ring near the bottom of the valve forms a seal, and the check ball keeps the oil from draining.
Okay, Sid. That takes care of high oil level. But what are you going to do about the other two reasons you gave for noisy tappets? Dirt in the oil and the possibility of a faulty tappet.
Impatient little rascal, isn't he?
Seems to me if the oil is dirty, I'd change it. And the oil filter, too. Of course, if metal particles or dirt had become stuck in the tappet, you'd probably have to replace the tappet.
A very good answer, my boy, but you're getting a little ahead of the story.
Yeah. Before we get into testing for tappet noise and replacing tappets, there's one other condition I want to tell you about. That's when you get a light tapping noise that lasts for a few minutes and then goes away. You may not hear it again for some time, then all of a sudden, it's back again.
Sounds like a tough one to find. Is it in the tappet?
Yes, but you'll only have that condition with the ball check design tappet. It's caused by a flat spot on the check ball. Of course, you have to replace the complete tappet.
Now, if someone will turn this record over, maybe we can find out what's causing the noise in Sid's car.
Well, then, John, what's the first thing you would do to decide whether the noise in this engine is caused by a hydraulic tappet?
Gosh, Sid, I don't know what I'd do first.
You don't. And I guess you weren't paying attention when Sid told you that air in the tappets was the most common cause. And didn't he say oil level in the crankcase had a lot to do with that?
Yeah, sure, I remember that. So I checked the oil level first.
Well, that's better. Be sure the oil level's right, not too high or too low. And check for water drops on the dipstick. Water in the oil will cause tappet noise, too.
And, of course, you'd check engine oil pressure.
If you had no oil pressure, you'd have plenty to worry about besides hydraulic tappets.
Right you are, my boy. Let's start this engine and see if we can run down the noise.
Good idea. We talked about it enough. Let's do something about it.
Okay. First, let's get this rocker cover off. Then we'll reinstall the spark plug so we can run the engine. Okay, start it up, Fred. Putting a little side thrust on each valve spring, one at a time, will tell whether the noise is caused by a cocked spring or a valve that isn't seating properly.
The noise would go away if it was caused by the spring or valve. Is that it?
That's right.
Well, I've tried all of them, and the noise didn't change a bit. So now what do we do?
You can usually pick out the noisy tappet by placing your finger on the side of the valve spring. You'll feel the knock through the spring. Or, another way, slide each rocker arm on the shaft away from the shaft bracket. The noise will be reduced if it's in the tappet.
Hey, I got it. Listen, I can change the noise by moving this rocker arm.
Good, that's the one. Shut it off, Fred. Okay, John, get your tools and we'll take that tappet out.
Lay that hammer down, boy. I don't trust you around this engine with a hammer in your hand.
I'll lay off him, Tech. He's a good kid.
I'll help you remove the manifold so we can get at the tappet chamber cover.
If this engine used the replaceable type tappet, we could remove the hydraulic unit from the tappet body with a special tool. But since this is the integral type tappet, we have to remove the manifold and the tappet chamber cover to get the tappet out.
It's easy enough to lift the tappet out after you get the pushrod out.
Yeah. Replacing the tappet is easy, but there's a lot of work to be done before and after. That's why you want to be sure you're right before you decide the noise is caused by the tappet. Here's the new tappet, John. I've squirted some oil through the feed hole and oiled the outside of the body. Never put a new tappet in dry.
Hey, aren't you going to clean and test the old one to see whether it needs replacing?
You took it out because it was noisy, didn't you? Suppose you test it, and it seems to be okay, so you put it back, and it's still noisy. You got a lot of work to do over again, haven't you?
Tech's right, Fred. If the tappet is noisy, you can't repair it, so it's a waste of time to put the old one back in. You can't tell whether cleaning it has removed the cause of noise until after you've got the engine back together and running. Then, if it's still noisy, you'll have to go through the same amount of work all over again to put in a new one. Nope. If you once take the integral type tappet out and you're positive it was noisy, you better play safe and install a new one.
When you're doing a valve and carbon job, it's a good plan to take the hydraulic tappets out for a good cleaning. Give them a leak down test to check for wear. If they haven't been noisy, they're not going to get noisy, so you can put them back in.
Well, let's finish this job because I've got something else on my mind I want to talk about.
Okay, Sid, we'll have this done in a few minutes.
Nice job, fellas. That new tappet's quieted down now, and our noise is gone. Now you know how to find a noisy tappet and what to do about it.
You said you had something else on your mind, Sid. What was it?
Oh, yeah. I want to talk about batteries. You know, I think we'd give our customers better service if we check the batteries of all new cars as soon as they're received. If the battery doesn't test 1250 or better, I think we ought to take it out and put it on charge overnight.
That's a smart idea, Sid. Battery men say a new battery needs breaking in, so to speak, to make it chemically active. Seeing that it is fully charged during its early life will give it a good start. If it is low, bring it up to full charge with a slow charging rate of 7 to 8 amps.
That makes sense to me. Most driving is done in heavy traffic with the radio playing and during this time of the year with the heater and maybe the defroster on.
Right. The combination of cold weather and slow driving makes it tough for the generator to keep the battery up to full charge. The generator doesn't cut in until pretty close to 20 miles an hour, does it?
It'll start a little below 20. But you don't get peak output until somewhere between 30 and 35 miles an hour. So at slow speed driving, you may be taking more out of the battery than the generator can put back in.
Can't you set the generator regulator so the battery will get more charge at slow speed?
That's not a good idea, John, because the owner would have to readjust it when warm weather comes, and he probably wouldn't do it. Then he'd overcharge the battery.
Well, how about using a larger battery?
Doesn't make any difference how big the battery is. If you take out more than you put in, you're going to end up with nothing any way you figure it. That's simple arithmetic. Now, you went to school, didn't you?
Yeah. So what's the answer to keeping a battery from running down?
Oh, mamma mia. You tell him, Sid.
Well, let's take a new Plymouth. Suppose it's driven by a doctor making house calls, or by a housewife taking the kids to school and making short trips to the store. That car isn't being driven enough to keep the battery up to charge. So, if we put a smaller pulley on the generator, it would reach a higher output at a slower car speed, right?
Why, sure. But can we get a smaller pulley?
Sure can. Plymouth now has a 3 1/4 inch pulley that does just that. And you can put it on an earlier model Plymouth if the overdrive brings about those kinds of driving conditions.
Well, that ought to be a big help.
Yeah, but remember, if you start the battery out in service with a full charge, chances are it'll give satisfactory performance for its normal life.
Okay, Tech. Any new cars I condition for delivery will have a fully charged battery.
Attaboy, John. Do a good job on that new car before the owner gets it, and he's gonna be happy. And he'll come back to you from time to time so you can keep his car in good operating condition.